Wow.
Apparently, 25 hours worth of party is a lot for a 10-year-old over a bank holiday weekend. So much so he got sent home from school on the Tuesday, completely exhausted. So just, temper the celebrations. It's the broken glass moment of being able to remember not to go too overboard on your simchas, even when you're 10.
Rabbiting on. Rabbiting on.
And welcome to a brand new podcast from the Movement for Reform Judaism, Rabbiting On. I'll let us all introduce ourselves. Maybe I'll start. I'm Rabbi Robin. I work at Manchester Reform Synagogue in the glorious city that is Manchester. Miriam, do you want to introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm Rabbi Miriam Berger. I've been rabbi at Finchley Reform Synagogue since I was ordained in 2006.
And I'm Rabbi Debbie Young Summers. I am part of the team at Edgware and Hendon Reform Synagogue, where I started April 2020. A fantastic time to start a new congregational job.
Yeah, quite.
So the aim is for us to get together to record an episode kind of every other week from now. And we're really just here to reflect on our lives, what's going on for us, in the hope that it will resonate with our audience and that you'll get in touch.
And we've got loads to talk about, and we're really looking forward to hearing from all of you as well. You can get in touch with us here on Twitter by tagging us at Reform Movement, or by sending an email to media@rjuk.org. We'd love to hear your comments, your questions, suggestions for what you'd like us to talk about.
Yeah, there's really so much to talk about, and in our preparation for this we've already been talking about so many different issues and thinking ahead to where we are in the world, in our personal lives, in work as well. We're situated at a moment, we've just had Mental Health Awareness Week, and mental health obviously has been a big part of our jobs and our personal time and family and kids and partners and everything in the last year particularly. And we've got our Festival of Shavuot, of Revelation, this weekend. And we'd of course been thinking and wanting to focus our chat on Monday. We've got a big day here in Britain of coming out of a particular moment of lockdown, with hugs maybe on the horizon. And we'll go into all of that. But of course, we can't really carry on without talking about the other thing that is kind of in our bodies, around us, in conversations, in our communities, at homes, around Israel and Palestine at the moment, the conflict that has just erupted and has been brewing, I think, for quite some time, but erupted recently in the last few days. So, well, let's just take a moment to just kind of hold that a little bit. I know that we've had to support people in the community, and thinking about, particularly coming into the weekend, what to say in those communal spaces this weekend. It's really hard. It's painful, isn't it?
It is, and I think everyone wants you to say what they want to hear. And there's no possible way that a rabbi can hold all of those views and opinions. And we want to create space for everyone to be able to hold where they're at, and space for everyone to be able to hear each other. I think there's been so much shouting on social media. We feel like we can solve what's going on by shouting as loud as we can on social media. And at the same time, social media can be really impactful. So I personally, I've been out trying to seek real conversations with people and engage with my interfaith partners and, my friends both in Israel and living in the West Bank, and, really engaging with the communities and trying to listen. But there's just so much shouting, and it's really hard to clarify what we want to say.
I find it hard that it's such a polarizing conversation as well, that as British Jews that come together in such a kind of extreme of diversity in so many different ways, and enjoy the fact that our communities are a real celebration of age and demography in different aspects. It's this conversation, it's when when the challenges are as great as they are at the moment in Israel, that you really see the polarizing perspectives and a real sense of needing to make people agree with you, or needing to tell other people that it's your perspective that's right. And I grapple with the idea that, you know, that it's this, you know, that we'll go into Shavuot and we'll be talking about God and revelation and Torah, and everyone's happy to sit in a kind of place of difference and difference of opinion. But with Israel, it's so polarizing.
Yeah, I often feel that, and I don't know whether this sounds too extreme or not, but, you know, that the shards of the missiles and the rockets, metaphorically in some way, litter our communities. That, like, it feels like there are shards of broken glass of, well, what if I say this? What's the reaction going to be? And I certainly have that. Like, I haven't put something on Twitter because I just don't know how to say something in such a short amount of words, small amount of words, that could do just this conversation. And I've definitely been like, I'm newer in this career than both of you are. I always like keep asking myself the question, like, well, as a rabbi, what's my role in this? Which is like a good question generally, isn't it? As a human, like, as a, in this role, what is it? And I think partly it's to create a space, as Debbie said, to really process some of the underlying emotions that we're all sharing, regardless of the political debates. That's, you know, for community, it's a place of healing. It's about connection. It's about ritual. And it's about giving space for all of that. And maybe hopefully modeling a way where it's not so polarized, where there is safety, where you can be held in it. But it's really tough.
I suppose another part of this for us as individuals is how we look after our own mental health in the midst of something that is so polarizing. You know, I've seen people post really beautiful, clear messaging and then receive a bombardment from either both sides of vile images of, you know, calling people liars, you know, attacking their morality. And actually, can I be effective in my encounters with people in the real world if I'm actually battling off ridiculous words online? So that sense of Mental Health Week, and, you know, people saying you have to look after yourself, you have to protect yourself, but we want you to say something. How do we hold all of that and protect ourselves?
And you understand why politicians in all sorts of perspectives, whatever's going on in the world, they often default to those words of, our thoughts and prayers are with, and then they're ridiculed for, like, well, what is that? You haven't said anything. But as rabbis, actually, well, that means a huge amount, especially when we're talking about Jews and Muslims, where actually it was the holy month of Ramadan that has exacerbated and begun this process. You start to ask that question of, well, we can't even get away with the with hiding behind words like our thoughts and prayers are with, because, well, what are you praying for? And what are you thinking? And it becomes so much harder.
And of course, our prayers are meant to reflect our actions, right? We're supposed to do as well as to pray. That's why tefillin are so moving for me. I put tefillin on because it reminds me that I need to do something with my arm, not just say the prayers in the room that I'm in at the moment. I need to go out and act. But when it comes to stuff that is so polarizing like this, I could be out there acting. I am out there acting, you know, I try to put money into places that are pursuing peace and try to have real conversations with real people. But then someone will tell me I'm not acting because I'm not saying it on Twitter. And, you know, how real is that world? It's really interesting.
So one of the challenges we are facing at the moment is one that I heard articulated beautifully from a lady in Ashkelon who was being interviewed on the BBC. And she described the fact that she was lecturing online to a group of adult students around Israel, and the air raid siren went off. So she, you know, rushed away from her computer, went to the shelters, and came back sometime later to her computer, where her students had simply sat patiently waiting for her, she was able to resume that lesson. And there's something about what does it mean for us to be able to say we have to hold on to what's going on in Israel, that as British Jews we know that that's happening and that it is occupying so much of our thoughts. And yet we also came to have this conversation about, you know, who are we and what does our weekend look like and how much of that weekend will be about what's going on in Israel and what else are we holding on to at the moment. So, you know, what do our weekends look like and how are we holding all of that together?
Yeah, well, I'm thinking about, we've got Shabbat, obviously, Friday night, Saturday night, and thinking about very much what we've been talking about how to create a space that can be helpful and meaningful for people to process some of this stuff for mental health. Like, it really does. I do always think that the rituals we have really are about holding mental health. If you think about the NHS five steps for well-being, it's like connect, giving, learning. I mean, really our rituals are all about that. If you think about our weekend, we've got a perfect construction. You couldn't have made it better, really, in a moment of crisis like this, to have a space where you have to come together as a community at least twice on Shabbat, and then on Sunday we're there all night together going into Monday for Shavuot, and we're talking about revelation. And for me, that's so powerful. I love Shavuot. It's one of my favorite festivals, all being under like the metaphoric mountain, Mount Sinai, holding ourselves there with all the blessings and the curses of what that is. And really, gosh, don't we feel it at the moment given what's going on. And then Monday we stand at Mount Sinai, and then I get to go into my mum and dad's house and have a hug and get fed for the first time in months. So actually, I'm really glad we're having this conversation, because I think there's quite a lot happening, isn't there? So it's good to talk about.
Yeah, I love Shavuot as well. I think it's one of the most maligned festivals, the most neglected festivals. There's a great blog called Out of the Ortho Box, where the author gets Shavuot writes a letter to Hanukkah about how unfair it is that Hanukkah gets all the attention and Shavuot no one notices. But Shavuot's a pilgrim festival. It's one of the top three. And it's so important. And Hanukkah's not even in the Tanakh. It's terrible. But I'm excited for the learning that goes on at Shavuot, the excitement to engage by our sort of core members who are looking to study and think about Torah. I always think it's an interesting one, though, when we celebrate revelation as progressive Jews who are kind of a little bit iffy about how true that moment is and what it means to still be turning Torah. For me, it's that reminder that these are the texts that have accompanied us through thousands of years of Jewish history and have been turned again and again to ask the questions, okay, how do we do this now? What does this mean for us today? And that for me is the Jewish job, in a way. That's what we're supposed to be engaging with. And yet we will reenact this moment of standing at Mount Sinai and stand up and hear the Ten Commandments. And I think it's really interesting to hold in tension those ideas of truth and whether it matters that it's literally true.
There's something for me about that piece of we all stood together at Sinai, and that we all went through it together. And actually, there's the very different images of we were sort of waiting together and as a community together and keeping each other kind of buoyant at a time of worry and doubt and what was going on, or even more so, you know, the midrash that you referred to, Robin, of the kind of the mountain being held over our heads and the kind of the trauma of that moment as well. And for me, there's something quite incredible about it being Shavuot that the rules are changing a little, and that sense of it being now that we can welcome people into our home, because there's something about we've shared this traumatic experience together, and yet who are we welcoming into our home now? Because what have they truly experienced? How have they been changed by this year? What does it mean not to have really been able to mourn with people, grieve with people, celebrate with people, experience, you know, their day-to-day in such a different way? And so, you know, it almost like the soldier coming back from war. Who are they now? Because we think we know, we think we're receiving them back into our homes in exactly the same way as we received them last year. But how have they been affected by it?
I also wonder if it will change our practices around hugging, particularly in congregations, right? You know, there in the High Holy Days, how many people do we shake hands and kiss with and then get sick 2 days later because we've got so many germs? And, you know, I think we've all had those moments of slightly inappropriate touch and slightly odd encounters with, physically, as women rabbis. And I just wonder if this gives us a kind of watershed moment to say, all right, we're gonna elbow bump now, or we're gonna do things differently. And if we'd want to, because I miss hugging. I really miss hugging.
I have to say my favourite part of the year is on Rosh Hashanah morning, where we receive the whole community, like, are arriving at a much bigger venue that we use on Rosh Hashanah. And I stand in the forecourt before the service starts as the community are kind of pouring in. And I love that moment of welcome. I love that moment of seeing everybody come together. And that difference of, will people be nervous to be received, you know, in that same way? How do you? That's how we're so conditioned to express a joy of seeing each other. And what does it mean on a small scale for Robin to walk back into her home, you know, with her parents and be able to have that moment of embrace? And on a communal level, what does it mean to be able to receive so many people at some point over the next coming months?
Yeah, I was really taken actually when you're talking before about the moment of, like, being at Mount Sinai, we all stood there together. And I kind of had forgotten, and thinking about where we are at the moment, that of course that isn't the arrival at the Promised Land. The Promised Land we don't really get to in the Torah, but after the revelation, after Monday, if we're looking, thinking about it in that way, we continue in the wilderness. So actually, like, the processing of the trauma, I don't think we're able to do. I think for me anyway, I can't really go there yet. Like, all I can do is, like, be in the moment of Monday, of, like, celebration, of revelation, of just pure enjoyment. And I think then the next period of, like, wandering and wilderness is going to be these moments that we're talking about, of being able to step into, like, the hug or a coffee with a friend, or meeting, I met our nephew for the first time recently. Like, those moments is when it's going to be a bit of a time to process. And just, I think we're talking about mental health, aren't we? I'm going to be really conscious and try to just notice what's arising and to let it release. You know, so if I need to have a cry, I'm just going to lean into that, because I think it's going to kind of probably bubble away in really odd ways that I'm not expecting at moments when I probably don't expect. Like, it probably won't be for me Rosh Hashanah morning. It'll probably be something like, this is embarrassing, but I went into Dunelm when the shops first opened and I cried. Like, it's going to be moments for me that are like that aren't big, but are just like, oh God, this is a remembering of what was. And I think that's the mental health aspect of just noticing it and sitting with it and helping me release it out of my body is going to be a huge part of the next part of the wandering post Monday.
So I've got my second jab this afternoon.
Ooh.
And at the first one, I sat down in those waiting chairs, having had Pfizer, I had to wait for 15 minutes, and just felt the tears pouring out of my face and kind of trying to behave myself because I'm in public, and it was just welling over. And the poor volunteers kept coming over, saying, are you okay? And I was like, this is just the emotional pain, it's not physical. You know, it's just holding so much grief and distance over the year. But in the other hand, I'm really proud of what Reform Judaism and our communities have achieved in being able to create connectivity and provide online spaces, which, you know, are not satisfying in the same way, but also I couldn't have lived without this year. You know, as someone who hadn't used technology on Shabbat for 17 years before lockdown, there was no question for me that I was going to jump on my computer and take services online, because that was how we were creating community, and it was pikuach nefesh to, you know, saving human life, to keep us separate but looking after one another within our mental health. Being together is so important for our mental health, and I think we can be really, really proud of that.
I think we have to be really careful how we take the next steps as well, so as not to let people down. That actually, for some people, our communities have been the most accessible than they've ever been, and we've had a few kind of communications recently from people who have kind of found us over this time, or found us differently, or become part of our online community, who are sort of saying, you know, please don't forget about us when you're in that moment of celebration of being able to come together again physically. I think now just being able to, you know, as Robin says, kind of just be really mindful of how different people are experiencing different moments, and not assume that it's the same for everybody. You know, what does it mean for the person who's not able to rush into someone's home next week, or doesn't want to rush into a restaurant, because actually they're still carrying so much of the sadness of this year. And how do we move at their pace and not at at the timeline that's been given to us by these somewhat arbitrary dates that we're all kind of holding on to so desperately?
Yeah, it's a new time, really, isn't it? It feels like that to me, that I know that anything that we do as a community is now going to be completely different, and it has to be. And like you said, we've got people who, members of our community as well, who are now in Germany, in America, in Israel, and they're part of our community. And I think everyone's realizing that we're not prepared to just turn into what we were before, and it has to be new. I don't know about you, but what I find this quite exhausting. Like, change is exhausting, and like this next bit, you'd imagine, maybe naively, I was, oh great, now we just get to go back to, and of course it's not that. It's again asking for more innovation, more creativity, on top of everything, which again is just, I keep banging the mental health drum, but you know, it is something that I'm trying really hard to like think about, and I'm journaling, I'm exercising, you know, just really to try and remain grounded in my body as well, and thinking through how I support myself in it. Because whilst it's all great, and it's, you know, it's brilliant that we're able to move back into life, and it's going to have energy and vibrancy, and I can have a meal out, and I've got one booked in, and I'm really excited, and Eurovision's back, which is delightful. It's actually also terrifying. Like, I'm, you know, I can feel myself full of anxiety when I'm around a lot of people. And I don't know about you two, but I have loads of unveiling stone settings in the diary from that awful time last year when we had so many people who passed away and had no one at the funeral, you know, just doing funerals online with nobody. And now we have so many that are going to happen with so many people and so much grief. So I'm really aware that like the ripples, and Jewish calendar catches it so well, doesn't it? Because we have these moments of coming together. So just, I'm kind of like just being very aware of those moments as well, those pockets that are going to be particularly intense.
Yeah, my summer is filled with stone settings, not only from people who passed away last year, but the year before, whose stone settings were delayed because people wanted to be able to be there. So yeah, I mean, at least two or three a week for months. But I think part of that challenge of not having been at funerals or only having a few people, I think our Jewish mourning rituals are so powerful psychologically. They are designed to preserve our mental health, right? You're supposed to cry, you're supposed to feel your torment, and to remember and to sob publicly. It's all encouraged, so that we process it and don't sweep it under the carpet, because that's where it festers and becomes a problem. And so much of that was taken away because we weren't able to be together and to mourn as we're used to doing. And it's how we hold and process that going forward. The stone settings for many are kind of that first big moment of grief, but is meant to be a different stage of grief. So it's, yeah, it's a lot to hold.
I hope you've got in your diary as well what I've got, which is also twice as many weddings. Yes. And I've never felt quite as privileged to be officiating at those weddings ever before, because there's a real sense of... we just haven't been able to celebrate the good things in life either, and what it means. And, you know, many of those couples have kind of endured lockdown together. They've got through the hardest year that they're, please God, will have to live through. And that sense of being able to kind of to celebrate what they've achieved as well, and to be able to kind of truly bring families together at a moment of joy, whilst we're also holding on to so much loss. And how many of those weddings will have missing seats at the simcha as well.
Or they have, you know, this is the fourth time that they've tried to organise the wedding. I'm doing one next week that it's the fourth shot for. And, you know, that sense of... I always joke that if you can make it through planning a wedding, marriage should be a breeze. I mean, that's even more true right now, I think.
But it's really encouraged people to think about, well, what is important? What do you want? What does this mean? Is it really about the, you know, colour scheme on the invitation? Or is it just about the fact that people will be there? So I think it's taught us all so much.
Taking that to a slightly more ridiculous level, I'm hoping that sense also pervades in children's birthday parties. It's been so nice not having to hire halls and entertainers, and, you know, let's, you know, do things a bit smaller and, you know, they're five.
Yeah. Wow. I wish you'd speak to Gabriel. He's just done his birthday list of people he'd want to invite, and it's about 30 at the moment. Because he's leaning into exactly as Miriam said. It's a simcha. We've not been able to do this. I'm inviting every single person I know. Yeah.
So we went so large this year. And managed to have groups of five in the garden over bank holiday weekends with like Ben and his five friends again and again and again.
Wow.
Apparently 25 hours worth of party is a lot for a 10-year-old over a bank holiday weekend. So much so he got sent home from school on the Tuesday completely exhausted.
No way.
So just, you know, temper the celebrations. It's the broken glass moment of being able to remember not to go too overboard on your simchas, even when you're 10.
We tried that last year in June. We were allowed one family at a time in the garden, so had a kind of 7 or 8 hour party for a five-year-old with a new plate of cupcakes every time and a new set of snacks just for them, and I was shattered. The kids were fine.
Wow, that's okay. I'm gonna take that in mind because our Gabriel's birthday is in June, so somewhere in the middle of like intense simcha but not overdoing it, so they get sent home from school of tiredness and collapse. Okay, great. This has been so wonderful. What a great way to begin the weekend and hold, I mean, everything that we're holding. We've gone from, you know, extreme sorrow and pain and confusion and heartbreak, and the trauma of the grief of the last year, the excitement of Shavuot and Monday. So there's just so much going on. It's just to be able to talk it through and, you know, to be with people who are listening and to have a wider conversation. And we would love to hear from anyone who's listened as part of this community now that we've just created in the last half an hour. So you can always get in touch on Twitter, tag us at Reform Movement, or you can send an email to media@rjuk.org. We'd love to hear your comments and questions and to be in dialogue with you all as we are here. So I think should I wrap up our first episode? Thank you to everyone joining us, and do subscribe. We're going to be back again in a couple of weeks. And until then, take care and keep well.
Chag Sameach.
Chag Sameach.
Chag Sameach.